churches. The church of Laodicea is one of those churches. And Jesus says to that church, you are neither hot nor cold. I'm about to vomit you out of my mouth. In other words, you're that tepid water, that lukewarm water. You see, Hierapolis was known for its hot springs, and they enjoyed their hot springs, but that was the hot springs water that came right down the pipe to the city of Laodicea, and by the time it got there, it was only lukewarm. It wasn't the cold, refreshing water that you might otherwise drink and so on. And so these were some churches that had been started. They were not churches that were started by the Apostle Paul. Isn't that interesting? You know, the Apostle Paul started a lot of churches in Corinth, in Ephesus. Ephesus wasn't too far away. By the way, Ephesus was about 100 miles towards the coast. And if you went about 100 miles in, that's where you'd find the city of Colossae, there in Asia Minor. And so this was where Paul was writing a letter to this church. There was probably a man who had come from there. His name is mentioned here in one of the first paragraphs. It talks about Epaphras, our beloved fellow servant. He's a faithful minister of Christ on your behalf and has made known to us your love in the Spirit. So apparently this guy named Epaphras came from Colossae. Probably he was the guy that planted that church there. And he left, by the way, someone else in charge while he was gone. That person is mentioned in the end of this book. His name was Aristarchus. Let me see if I can find it here real quick. If I can't locate it real quick, we'll just skip past it. I don't see it. Okay, so we're moving on. So anyway, he left somebody else in charge while Epaphras decided, you know what, I need to go talk to the Apostle Paul, and I know where he is. You know where the Apostle Paul was? The Apostle Paul was in prison. The book of Colossians is a book that was written, a letter that was written by the Apostle Paul while he was in prison. There were a number of other epistles that were written. They're called prison epistles for that reason. Colossians is one of them. The book of Ephesians is another one of them. The book of Philippians is another one of them. And the book of Philemon. Philemon was a very personal letter that Paul wrote on behalf of one of his fellow servants named Onesimus, if you remember that story. So the book of Philemon. But these four epistles, letters, were written by Paul while he was in prison. And the occasion of this letter to the church at Colossae, the Colossian letter, was written because Epaphras had said, you know what, I need to talk to Paul. We got some stuff going on here. We just need his wisdom. We need his insight. He's an apostle of Christ Jesus. Let me see if I can go find him. Let me see if I can go talk to him. And so off he went to Rome. It was quite a trip, but he went to Rome, and he found the Apostle Paul in chains. How do we know he was in chains? Well, he ends his letter. If you look at the end of the book of Colossians, in Colossians chapter 4, he says, I, Paul, write this greeting with my own hand. Remember my chains. Grace be with you. So Paul's in chains. You know, the Apostle Paul, such a man of faith. You and I, we'd be in chains. We'd be moping about, right? Oh, man, poor me. Look at me. I can't get out and do the work God's called me to do. What am I going to do? Here I am, chained to the law. God, when are you going to set me free? God, when are you going to set me free? God, when are you going to set me free? And Paul was in chains for quite a few years. He was in chains long enough that the church in Colossae had heard about it and knew that he was in chains. And remember, there wasn't internet. There wasn't even news back then. I mean, how would they even know? It was word of mouth, and it would take years for a message like that to get somewhere. And so they eventually heard Paul is in chains in Rome. And so Epaphras said, I got to go talk to him because we have got a problem. Do you know what their problem was? It was one of the very first heresies that the church ever had to deal with. Some of you right now are thinking, Gnosticism, if you will. Gnosticism was a religion that was very syncretistic. It came to the fore about the mid-100s AD and lasted until after the 300s AD. syncretistic religion, and so people of a Jewish background might embrace aspects of Gnosticism. People of a Christian background, unfortunately, embrace principles of Gnosticism. And whatever different religion you were, you could kind of wrap this Gnosticism teaching into your religion. We do some of this today, unfortunately, Christians do today, with things like Buddhism. Did you know that Christians today, a lot of Christians are practicing aspects of Buddhism? I'm talking about yoga. Now, you say, well, yoga, that's just exercise, right? Well, I suppose it can be. The problem is, if you're really doing yoga, you're talking about that core. That core. What is that core? It's a spiritual thing. It's, you know, and if you're doing yoga, you're starting to practice Buddhism. It's kind of a syncretism. And I would say to you that it's not something that we should be doing. Should we be exercising? Of course. And if you want to go stretch and do the double dog barking thing, whatever it's called, yeah. Downward dog, okay. Double dog dairy, I guess that's what I'm saying. You know, and you're doing it for exercise, okay, well, I don't know. I wouldn't do it, but there are other things you can do. But that's kind of what went on in that first couple centuries of the history of the church. It was a rough and tumble world doctrinally and spiritually. These were not easy times for the church to grow up and develop, and it became doubly difficult because Rome itself was coming down on the church and killing Christians for following Jesus and so on in the hundreds and 200s and 300s AD. So these were not easy times. But in Colossae, apparently what there was developing was the very first heresy that the church ever had to deal with. And by the way, why am I preaching on Colossians right now? Just as a history lesson? Is that what I'm doing, a history lesson here? No. The same heresy that the Colossae church faced is the same heresy that we today face. Is this reverb still on? If you turn that off for me, okay, thanks. The very first heresy that they had to deal with, we have to deal with today. And it is the heresy that teaches that if you want to be a Christian, you have to come to Christ through the practice of Judaism. You familiar with what I'm talking about? Anybody? You know what I'm talking about? Some of you maybe know people that are embracing this concept and this idea. This idea that if we really want to live lives that please God, we have to celebrate the Jewish festivals. Now, I'm not saying there's anything wrong with celebrating the Jewish festivals, but it's this idea that says this is how you come to and walk in relationship with and please God by doing these things. And, of course, dietary laws, don't eat certain foods and so on. Even though the New Testament tells us plainly, in the Gospel of Mark, chapter 7, it tells us that, and this is almost an exact quote, it says something like, in saying this, Jesus declared all foods clean. Well, did he or didn't he? That's what God's Word says. Yeah, if you don't want to eat pork because pork's not as healthy of meat as other meat, well, that's fine. But if you're doing it for religious purposes because you think this is what God still expects of you, you are mistaken. Why? Why is this such a big deal? It's a big deal because in Christ is our sufficiency. In fact, the whole point of the book of Colossians is to say that this is who Jesus Christ is. I want you to understand who Christ is, and therefore I want you to understand who you are in Christ. And so when Epaphras came to Paul, he said, Paul, we got some teaching going on here, and I don't know how to address it. I don't know how. And Paul says, I tell you what, I'll write a letter. So he writes a letter. Look at how he starts his letter. Colossians chapter 1, verse 1. It says this. Paul, an apostle of Christ Jesus by the will of God, and Timothy, our brother. Timothy was in chains with him, by the way. So were some other men. He'll mention them later. To the saints and faithful brothers in Christ at Colossae. Grace to you and peace from God our Father. A typical kind of introduction to a letter in that day. You would always give words of salutation and, And in this case, Paul is identifying himself. He's kind of laying out his credentials, if you will. He says, Paul, an apostle of Christ Jesus by the will of God. Now, how was he an apostle of Christ Jesus? Was he an apostle because he was one of the 12 and walked with Jesus? No. Did Paul ever see Jesus with his own eyes when he walked on this earth before he was crucified? We don't know. Maybe, maybe not. But we know through Paul's testimony that as he was traveling from Jerusalem to Damascus so that he could take a letter to arrest Christians there, to persecute them and put them in prison and even to have them put to death, as he was on his way to the Damascus, on that road, God spoke to him. Jesus spoke to him, knocked him down to the ground and spoke to him and called him to be an apostle of his. Paul met Jesus for himself. That was the qualification of being an apostle. So Paul, when he says, Paul, an apostle by the will of God, he meant that. He wasn't an accidental apostle. None of them were, of course. But you understand, Paul is saying, these are my credentials. I'm an apostle. What is an apostle? An apostle in biblical times was one of that select group. The apostleship was a fairly limited category. There weren't just tons of apostles walking around. Oh, hey, can I be apostle? Sure. Here you go. Here you are. You're an apostle. Go. It didn't work that way. Okay. Now, the Bible talks about the gift of apostleship, and I believe that all the gifts of the Spirit are still relevant today, so we would have to discern what that means. You see, the word apostle, the Greek word apostle, is a compound word, two words in Greek, apa and stelo. Stelo means to speak. Apa is the preposition from, to speak from. Or another way to translate it is to speak on behalf of someone else. An apostle was an emissary, if you will. Somebody that if I was an important person and I said, Tammy, I want you to be my apostle and I want you to go talk to that church over there, and you came and you said, hey, I'm here, I'm an apostle of Larry Long, and they all went, ooh, Larry Long, okay, we'll sit down and listen to what you have to say. Of course, we don't have it, but so an apostle was somebody who was sent on behalf of someone else to speak on their behalf. And Paul is saying he's an apostle of Christ Jesus, speaking on behalf of Jesus by the will of God. And, of course, he's including Timothy, who is his very close right-hand man at this point. He says to the saints and faithful brothers in Christ at Colossae, saints, who's he talking about? He's talking about everybody in Christ. You see, everybody in Jesus Christ is a saint. That's what the Bible says. Now, I know that there are churches that have said, no, the saints are really kind of this special select group of people. There's certain categories they have to go through, and they've created this whole category of special super Christian. Well, that's not what the Bible says about saints. The saint says anybody who's in Christ is a saint. To the saints and faithful brothers in Christ at Colossae. To the faithful brothers. What do you think he's implying? Well, if there are people who are caught up in this heresy, they probably would not be included in this faithful brothers category, would they? This heresy is serious business. This heresy is today leading people away from Jesus Christ. We had a Christian and Missionary Alliance pastor who was pastoring down in Corpus Christi, Texas, when I first came into this district. As you know, I pastored for 10 and a half years in South Louisiana before I came up here to Midland, Texas. So I've been in the ministry now for almost 25, well, a little bit more than 25 years now, almost. And so about 24, 23 years ago, we had a pastor down in Corpus Christi, and he was interested in the Hebrew language. He was studying it for himself, and he was trying to learn it, trying to speak it. And so he found out that I'd studied Hebrew. You know, he wanted to talk about it. And I was always a little bit like, where did you get that? You know, and people who study the Hebrew language, anybody who studies the biblical language has this idea, if they're not careful, that there's something magical about that original language. And if we can just learn that original language is language. Some languages are more expressive in some ways than other languages are. The Hebrew language is a very pictorial language, a very beautiful language. When you study the Hebrew language, you can begin to see things, but you know what? Our translations are good too. You don't have to read the Bible in the original languages to know what the Bible teaches. Now, it helps. It helps you to study it, but there are lots of resources that you and I can buy today and open up, and as we study the Bible, we can see and we can learn these things. We don't have to know the original languages. Well, this guy wanted to know Hebrew, and after a while, he started wearing a skull cap, and after a while, he started calling himself a Messianic Jew. Well, I believe that Messianic Judaism is a legitimate category of how the Christian faith can be practiced. Jews for Jesus is a powerful ministry that reaches lost Jewish people and wins them to Christ and shows them how they can maintain a connection to their Jewish culture and their Jewish family while still recognizing Jesus as their Messiah. There's nothing wrong with celebrating the Jewish festivals. There's nothing wrong with eating in a Jewish dietary manner. There's nothing wrong with being circumcised. We're not going to have a show of hands here, but probably several of you men here have been circumcised. There's nothing wrong with that. Okay? But if you're doing those things because you believe that's what God requires of you, then you are acting contrary to the new covenant. And this is the heresy of the covenant church. Well, this man, who is a pastor, eventually decided that Jesus wasn't the Messiah, and he became a full-blown Jew. To be Jewish, by the way, is not just a matter of ethnic heritage. To be Jewish is really a religious commitment. You understand that? You can convert to Judaism. I don't recommend it. The entire book of Hebrews, by the way, is written to address these people who are turning away from the Christian faith and going back into Judaism. Did you know that? The entire book is written to address that phenomenon. Did you know that Paul, in almost every one of his epistles, at some point or another, speaks against this heresy? Did you know that? It's remarkable. When you begin to know what this heresy is and you begin to look for it, you're just struck by how often Paul says no to this. The full sufficiency is in Christ. It's in living the life of Christ's Spirit dwelling in and through you. All of these things were only pointing at that. This is that, Paul is saying. And so he writes this letter. Let's look at it. It really wouldn't be too long for me just to read this letter to you. So let's pretend here today that we're the church at Colossae. And I'm the guy that Paul left in charge, or that Epaphras left in charge. I think his name was Aristarchus, but for some reason that doesn't sound right. It's not Aristarchus because he's with Paul as a prisoner. Where is it? Verse 17? What's his name? Archippus. Verse 17. And say to Archippus, see that you fulfill the ministry that you have received in the Lord. So when... I've lost the other guy's name. When Epaphras left Colossae, he left Archippus in charge. So let's pretend I'm Archippus. We're the Colossae church. The letter's been brought back, and I'm now reading this letter from Paul. And we understand, because an apostle of Christ Jesus by the will of God, this is really a letter from God. Right? So let's read. Paul, an apostle of Christ Jesus by the will of God, and Timothy, our brother, to the saints and faithful brothers in Christ at Colossae, grace to you and peace from God our Father. We always thank God, the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, when we pray for you, since we heard of your faith in Christ Jesus and the love that you have for all the saints. Because of the hope laid up for you in heaven, of this you have heard before in the word of truth, the gospel, which has come to you, as indeed in the whole world it is bearing fruit and growing, as it also does among you since the day you heard it and understood the grace of God in truth. Just as you learned from Epaphras, our beloved fellow servant, He is a faithful minister of Christ on your behalf and has made known to us your love in the Spirit. And so, from the day we heard, we have not ceased to pray for you, asking that you may be filled with the knowledge of his will and the spiritual wisdom and understanding, so as to walk in a manner worthy of the Lord, fully pleasing to him, bearing fruit in every good work, and increasing in the knowledge of God. May you be strengthened with all power according to his glorious might, for all endurance and patience with joy, giving thanks to the Father who has qualified you to share in the inheritance of the saints in light. He has delivered from us from the dominion of darkness and transferred us to the kingdom of his beloved Son, in whom we have redemption, the forgiveness of sins. He, that's Christ, is the image of the invisible God, the firstborn of all creation. For by him all things were created in heaven and on earth, visible and invisible, whether thrones or dominions or rulers or authorities, all things were created through him and for him. How important is Jesus? He's the creator. And he is before all things, and in him all things hold together. Not only is he the creator, but he's the one that holds this all together. And he is the head of the body, the church. How important is the church? He is the head of the body, the church. He is the beginning, the firstborn from the dead, and in everything he might be preeminent. For in him all the fullness of God was pleased to dwell, and through him to reconcile to himself all things, whether on earth or in heaven, making peace by the blood of his cross. And you who were once alienated and hostile in your mind, doing evil deeds, he has now reconciled in his body of flesh by his death, in order to present you holy and blameless and above reproach before him. If indeed you continue in the faith, stable and steadfast, not shifting from the hope of the gospel that you heard, which has been proclaimed in all creation under heaven, and of which I, Paul, became a minister. Are these people in Colossae in danger of turning away from the faith? They are. Now, Paul says, I rejoice in my sufferings for your sake, and in my flesh I am filling up what is lacking in Christ's affliction for the sake of his body, that is the church, of which I became a minister according to the stewardship from God that was given to me for you, to make the word of God fully known, the mystery hidden for ages and generations, but now revealed to his saints. Does Paul believe he's writing to them the words of God? He does. To them God chose to make known how great among the Gentiles are the riches of the glory of the mystery, which is Christ in you, the hope of glory. Him we proclaim, warning everyone and teaching everyone with all wisdom, that we may present everyone mature in Christ. For this I toil, struggling with all his energy that he powerfully works within me. You see, Paul is saying, this isn't just for a select group of people. This is for everybody. The heresy taught, no, only the people that are in the club. Let's go. Paul continues, for I want you to know how great a struggle I have for you and for those at Laodicea and for all who have not seen me face to face. See, Paul had never met these people face to face. That their hearts may be encouraged, being knit together in love, to reach all the riches of the full assurance of understanding and the knowledge of God's mystery, which is Christ, in whom we are hidden all the treasures of wisdom and knowledge. I say this in order that no one may delude you with plausible arguments, for though I am absent in body, yet I am with you in spirit, rejoicing to see your good order and the firmness of your faith in Christ. How important is order in the church? I hear people say to me all the time, oh, I really don't like the organized church. What church do you like? It's not organized. It's not orderly. What is it? Paul is trying to bring some order here. Therefore, he says, as you receive Christ Jesus the Lord, so walk in him, rooted and built up in him and established in the faith, just as you were taught, abounding in thanksgiving. See to it that no one takes you captive by philosophy and empty deceit, according to human tradition, according to the elemental spirits of the world, and not according to Christ. For in him the whole fullness of the deity dwells bodily, and you have been filled in him, who is the head of all rule and authority. In him you also were circumcised with a circumcision made without hands by putting off the body of the flesh by the circumcision of Christ. What was one of the aspects of this heresy that was being taught? That if you're a Gentile and you want to be part of the covenant community of God, faith in Christ is not enough. You got to get circumcised too.
Well,
hang on a minute. I'm a 40-year-old man. What are you talking about? Oh, yeah, you got to get circumcised. This was part of the heresy. Kind of a mixture of this proto-Gnosticism and a Judaizing gospel. So, he says, in him you were circumcised with a circumcision made without hands, by putting off the body of the flesh by the circumcision of Christ, having been buried with him in baptism, in which you were also raised with him through faith in the powerful working of God who raised him from the dead. How important is water baptism? Jesus got baptized to show us by example how important this should be for us. Have you been baptized? Have you been buried with him in baptism? This is one of the reasons why we believe in baptism by immersion. And you who are dead in your trespasses and the uncircumcision of your flesh, God made alive together with him, having forgiven all our trespasses, by canceling the record of debt that stood against us with its legal demands. This he set aside, nailing it to the cross. He disarmed the rulers and authorities and put them to open shame by triumphing over them in him. Therefore, let no one pass judgment on you in questions of food or drink, or with regard to a festival, or a new moon, or a Sabbath. Are people today trying to pass judgment on people because they're not keeping the Jewish festivals? You bet they are. Here Paul is saying, don't let that happen. These are a shadow of the things to come, but the substance belongs to Christ. Are you with me? You see what Paul is telling them? Let no one disqualify you, insisting on asceticism and the worship of angels, going on in detail about visions puffed up without reason by the sensuous mind, and not holding fast to the head, from whom the whole body, nourished and knit together through his joints and ligaments, grows with a growth that is from God. For if with Christ you died to the elemental spirits of this world, why, as if you were still alive to the world, do you submit to its regulations? Do not handle, do not taste, do not touch, referring to the things that all perish as they are used, according to the human precepts and the teachings. Why? These have indeed an appearance of wisdom in promoting self-made religion and asceticism and severity to the body, but they are of no value in stopping the indulgence of the flesh. If, then, you have been raised with Christ, seek the things that are above, where Christ is seated at the right hand of God. Set your minds on the things that are above, not on the things on this earth. For you have died, and your life is hidden with Christ in God. When Christ, who is your life, appears, then you also will appear with him in glory. Talking about resurrection. This proto-Gnosticism taught, oh no, the flesh is evil. We need to starve the flesh, and hopefully the flesh will die, and then our spirits will go to heaven. No, this is talking about not just our spirits going to heaven, but when Christ comes, the whole body is going to be resurrected. And we're going to dwell with him, it says, appear with him in glory. Amen? Amen. So, listen. Put to death, therefore, what is earthly in you. Sexual impurity. Sexual immorality, impurity, passion, evil desires, and covetousness, which is idolatry. On the account of these, the wrath of God is coming. In these you too once walked, when you were living in them, but now you must put them away, all away. Anger, wrath, malice, slander, and obscene talk from your mouth. Do not lie to one another, seeing that you have put off the old self with all its practices, and have put on the new self, which is being renewed in knowledge and in the image of its creator. Here there is not Greek and Jew, circumcised and uncircumcised, barbarian, Scythian, slave, free, but Christ is all and in all. Do you see what what Paul is saying? This special club, this special Judaizing club that is trying to separate those people who are practicing these boundary laws of Judaism. There were three of them. There was the law of circumcision, there was the law of food or dietary laws, and there were the laws of the festivals and the Sabbath. These boundary laws had separated the Jewish people from all the other people in the world according to God's word, according to God's leadership in the Old Covenant. But now Paul is saying, in Christ, he is the fullness of all of that. That was only a shadow of what was to come, and what was to come has now come, and it is the fullness that is in Christ. When somebody says to you, oh, well, I'm practicing, I'm a Messianic Jew, and I'm practicing Judaism, ask them, why? Why? What are you doing? Why? Now, if they're Jewish, they say, well, I'm maintaining a connection to my Jewish heritage, and my family's not converted. Cool. I understand. But this heresy is so deeply rooted in our city. Did you know that the synagogue of Satan broadcast from our city is called God's Learning Channel? Now, it has good programming on it. There's lots of good programming there. But constantly they are hitting this drumbeat of being Jewish and practicing Jewish and playing Jewish. And they'll get people on there who are of Hispanic heritage, and they'll say, well, we really are Jews. We're part of the lost tribe of Israel. And they do DNA tests on them. No, there's no Jewish DNA in them, but they claim it anyway, and away they go. I had a pastor here in town one time sitting at a table eating together, and he looked at me and he said, well, I'm Jewish. And I said, really? I said, what makes you Jewish? He said, well, I'm Cherokee. Oh, okay. Well, the Cherokees were part of the lost tribe of Israel. Oh, okay, I hadn't heard that. They do a DNA test. You know what? There's no Jewish DNA in there. By the way, I am 0.03% Ashkenazi Jew. I'm also 0.02% Sub-Saharan West African. So I'm one of the brothers, too. That's correct. I'm a very high percentage of Neanderthals, as a matter of fact. Yes. So, what's the point? You know, the Apostle Paul addresses this issue in the book of Romans as well. Are you aware of that? He asks the question, who is a true child of Abraham? Is the true child of Abraham a child of circumcision by the flesh or by the Spirit? Do you know the answer? By the Spirit. Where did I leave off here? Put on then, as God's chosen ones, holy and beloved, compassion, kindness, humility, meekness, and patience, bearing with one another, and if one has a complaint against another, forgiving each other as the Lord has forgiven you, so you also must forgive. And above all these, put on love, which binds everything together in perfect harmony. And let the peace of Christ rule in your hearts, to which indeed you were called in one body, and be thankful. Let the word of Christ dwell in you richly, teaching and admonishing one another in all wisdom, singing and psalms and hymns and spiritual songs with thankfulness in your hearts to God. And whatever you do in word or deed, do everything in the name of the Lord Jesus, giving thanks to God the Father through him. You know what I think? I think when Paul wrote his letter to the church at Ephesus, the book that we call Ephesians, he was probably at the same time writing this book, because some of the language is almost identical. He's giving them the same exhortation. When you're in Christ, this is the kind of person you ought to be. It goes on. It says, wives, submit to your husbands as is fitting in the Lord. Husbands, love your wives and do not be harsh with them. Children, obey your parents in everything, for this pleases the Lord. Fathers, do not provoke your children, lest they become discouraged. Slaves, obey in everything those who are your earthly masters, not by way of eye service as people pleasers, but with sincerity of heart, fearing the Lord. What other letter did Paul write from the Roman chains that he was in? He wrote the book of Philemon. Philemon was written to send back with Onesimus, who was a slave, a servant of, what was that guy's name? Anybody remember? I can't think of it. Anyway, he mentions him in the book of Philemon, and he says, look, I'm sending Onesimus back to you. I want you to remember that while Onesimus was your servant, in fact, he is a brother in the Lord, and that changes the nature of your relationship. Right? So here's Paul saying, but to the servants, to the slaves, he says, serve, do your work heartily as for the Lord and not for men, knowing that from the Lord you will receive the inheritance as your reward. You are serving the Lord Christ, for the wrongdoer will be paid back for the wrong he has done, and there is no partiality. Masters, treat your slaves justly and fairly, knowing that you also have a master in heaven. Do you understand that slavery was a little bit different than the slavery that we grew up knowing in the 1800s here in America? Most of the slavery was an indentured servanthood. You could work your way out of it. It wasn't the absolute possession of the human being that we knew here in America. And so these words can apply to us in our employment. Right? Then he goes on. Continue steadfastly in prayer, being watchful in it with thanksgiving. At the same time, pray also for us that God may open to us a door for the word to declare the mystery of Christ, on account of which I am in prison, that I may make it clear which is how I ought to speak. Conduct yourself. By the way, is it hard sometimes to speak the word of God clearly? It is. There are some deep mysteries, some deep things here. Sometimes we try to talk about them and preach about them and teach about them. It's not always easy. Pray, Paul says, that I might do it with clarity. He says, conduct yourselves wisely toward outsiders, making the best use of time. Let your speech be always gracious, seasoned with salt, so that you may know how you ought to answer each person. And then he gives some final greetings. Tychicus will tell you about my activities. He's apparently the one now that's brought the letter back to the church at Colossae. Tychicus will tell you about my activities. He's a beloved brother and faithful minister and fellow servant in the Lord. I have sent him to you for this very purpose, that you may know how we are and that he may encourage your hearts. And with him, Onesimus, that's the one who is written about in the book of Philemon, our faithful and beloved brother who is one of you, they will tell you of everything that has taken place here. Aristarchus, my fellow prisoner, greets you, and Mark, the cousin of Barnabas, concerning whom you have received instructions. If he comes to you, welcome him. And Jesus, who is called Justice. These are the only men in the circumcision among my fellow workers for the kingdom of God, and they have been a comfort to me. Epaphras, who is one of you, a servant of Christ Jesus, greets you, always struggling on your behalf in his prayers that you may stand mature and fully assured in the will of God. For I bear him witness that he has worked hard for you and for those in Laodicea and Hierapolis. Luke, the beloved physician, greets you, as does Demas. Give my greetings to the brothers at Laodicea and Nympha and the church in her house. And when this letter has been read among you, have it read also in the church of the Laodiceans, and see to it that you also read the letter from Laodicea. And say to Archippus that see that you fulfill the ministry that you have received in the Lord. I, Paul, write this greeting with my own hand. Remember my chains. Grace be with you. That letter was read before the church at Colossae, knowing the struggle that they were having, knowing the struggle that we have in our own city here in the Permian Basin with this Judaizing heresy. What words of instruction have you heard today that would give you an understanding that you can be confident in Christ and in him alone, and you don't have to do all of these other things in order to be acceptable to God? Do you understand the gospel of grace in truth today? This is a hard issue, my friends. We have had people leave this church because I would not yield to their teaching in this regard. People that we have had very high regard for. One man was an elder. last thing. Our time is up. If you have your Bible. Oh,